Hey, good morning, Discovery. How are you guys doing? Super Bowl Sunday, yeah? Amen. Most importantly, it's God Sunday. So whenever you guys are ready, let me have you guys stand up. Let's get ready to worship Jesus. Come on. Come on, guys. Hey. Let praise be the weapon that silences the enemy. Let praise be the weapon that conquers all anxiety. So let it rise. Let praise arise. Come on, church. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. So let it rise. Let praise arise. Hey! We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Oh, fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of victory's on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh, let faith be the song that overcomes the raging sea. Hey! Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. So let it rise. Let faith arise. Come on, let's declare it. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Oh, fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of victory's on our side. Forever lifts him high. Let all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh. God is good, church, amen? The one who the Son sets free is free indeed, amen? So, church, even for just 1 second, come on, let's just celebrate that freedom, right? I'll ask everybody, is it okay to let loose for a second? So wherever we are, wherever we stand, come on, let's just celebrate that freedom, come on. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you, come on. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. Oh, fear cannot survive when we praise you. The God of victory's on our side. Forever lifts him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. Oh, fear cannot survive. No, we cannot. God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lifts him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, 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 oh. We praise you, yeah. Jesus, we praise you, yeah. Oh, 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 oh. We praise you. God of praise. Hey.
Whew. That was fun.
Praise God. So this morning we're going to introduce a new song. The name of the song is Evidence. I'm going to sing the chorus for you, then I ask that you join in.
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see the promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life.
Let's join together.
I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. All throughout my history, your faithfulness has walked beside me. The winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your goodness all over my life, all over my life. I see your promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life. Help me remember when I'm weak, the evidence is here. Why should I fear? Oh, the evidence is here. You unravel me with a melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance from my enemies, till all my fears are gone. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Mother's womb, chosen me. Love has called my name. I've been born again into your family. Your blood flows through my veins. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. Child of God. Sons and the daughters, let us sing our freedom. Oh, 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 oh. Perfect love. split the sea so I could walk right through it. My fears are drowned in perfect love. You rescued me and I will stand and sing. I am a child of God. I am a child. Child of God, I am a child of God. I am a child of God. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God. I'm no longer a slave to fear. I am a child of God.
Name it is the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus. What a powerful name it is, the name of Jesus.
That we can meet with you today, and that God, you can transform us, that there's an expectation in our lives, in our hearts, in our minds, Lord Jesus, that as we focus on your word, God, that we're transformed by it. I just sense that people came into discovery today, and God, in some of us, there might be a disappointment. In some of us, there might be a feeling of a letdown in day-to-day life and things that are going on in families, in our homes, and in our lives. And God, you're going to speak life today in such a way that raises us up with hope, that raises us up, Lord Jesus, that as we center ourselves in you, there's transformation that occurs, God, and that's going to happen today. And I just pray, Lord, for every person worshiping and gathered as we focus on the beautiful name that's above every name, that the thing that changes, God, is you show up and we realize who you are. And when we realize who you are, we can stand up, Lord Jesus, in hope. We can stand up with faith, God, because of who you are. When we remember the name of the Lord our God, remember that Yahweh is on our side, that sovereign God, you're with us. You're with us. You lead us by fire, God. You speak to us. And we know where to go. We know what to do, God, because of you. And God, you're going to do that today. That there's people that are searching today. There's people that want something more. And God, you're here to say, I'm going to provide that for you today. That, Lord Jesus, we center ourselves in who you are. Just believe that transformation through your word, through you today, through the presence of Jesus, and we have come to encounter you, not go through the motions of a church service today. This is a church family where we, God, depend upon your word. We depend upon an encounter with you week after week, Lord Jesus, and day after day in our day-to-day lives, Lord Jesus. I just encourage you, close your eyes right now. Be silent just where you are. Experience the touch of Jesus upon your life. Take a moment, Jesus. We can be still and know that you are God. We want to experience that today. May be seated. We're going to continue our series, Led by Fire. Before we jump back into it, I just want to remind everybody that as a body, as a family, we're really looking forward to February the 25th as we relaunch Group Captains. We need to plan ahead over the next couple of weeks. We'll in the lobby be setting up and give you the opportunity to sign up to be a part of a group. We met with group leaders to begin planning the launch of groups last week. And I'll tell you right now, our student ministry at Discovery already has this place rocking on Thursday nights. There's momentum in our student ministry. and that's going really well. And I just believe in that as we add children's and give focus to children's with as we relaunch Discovery Kids and do a new thing here on Thursday nights with kids and adult groups that we're picking up momentum as we continue through 2021. God has a great plan for our church family together this year. Do you believe that? Come on, it's gonna be a great year. All right, we're gonna jump into the Led by Fire. Open up your Bibles to Exodus chapter 5, as we'll be studying chapter 5 and 6 today. Let's do it.
Moses, your father's called me God, and I have made you an orphan of grace. I have sustained you in the house of the king. Now see your purpose. For I have heard the cries of my people. I have seen the weight of their oppression. And I have come down to deliver them. And I will stretch out my hand against Egypt and guide my people to a land I have prepared. I will make you my mouthpiece. I will make you a shadow of one greater to come. I will lead you as I have led you. Now go!
All right, so we're going to pick things up in the story of Exodus as Moses is on a journey with God. And he's being raised up to be led by fire. He's being raised up to lead God's people out of one season of existence, a season of slavery, into a new season of being led by God in the wilderness, of being led by God during a time of transition, and then bringing them later into the promised land. And God has you and I on a journey where God is showing us, he's teaching us that on that journey, every single moment is important. And that on that journey, he's equipping us, he's showing us, he's teaching us what we're going to need for the season that's ahead as he brings us into a new season, as he raises us up for his purpose. And his plan and purpose is for you and I not to live in captivity. His plan and purpose is for you and I to live in freedom. Come on, how many of you guys want to experience freedom on a day-to-day basis in your life? And that's what God is bringing us into, God's plan for us, and what this series is all about, that he doesn't want us to stay where we are at. You got to know that. He does not want you to stay where you are at spiritually. That God's plan is to grow us in this moment as we move into the new season, as we move into the new time. He wants to develop us. He wants to grow us. He wants to bring us to a place where we're led by the Spirit of God in our hearts and lives, and we experience day-to-day freedom as we keep in step with the Holy Spirit. And we experience a power that we never thought was imaginable in our day-to-day lives because of the Spirit of God leading and moving us into the next place. And this morning we pick it up in Exodus chapter 5, and my message is titled, Dealing with Disappointment. Dealing with disappointment. Every great leader, every great person experiences adversity. And as you experience adversity and difficult moments, that you and I might face disappointment in our life. Moses is no exception. You and I are no exception. Which let me just shout out and say today that if you are a Tampa Bay Buccaneers fan, you will need this message later on today. Dealing with disappointment. Just saying. All right. I'm going to give you guys the chance to represent today. How many of you guys are rooting for Kansas City today? Go Chiefs. All right. How many of you guys are rooting for Buccaneers today? Come on, go Buccaneers. All right. How many of you guys are rooting for the commercials, that the commercials will be better than the game itself? All right. All right. We got some fans in the house today. Did you hear about the store owner that bet the farm on the Super Bowl? Jim Mattress Mac McInville, a Houston furniture guy, bet the farm. He bet $3.46 million in the largest Super Bowl bet made this year on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers to cover the 3.5 points in the game today. His millions would be $2.8 million. Wow. Please don't ever do that. I'm just saying. Please don't ever do that. The Bible says, trust in the name of the Lord our God, not trust in the name of Tom Brady. All right. So we got to place our confidence in God. And I, you know, I'm going to send him my message because he's going to be dealing with disappointment after he loses $3.46 million today. And I'm not saying that prophetically. Like, please don't. There will be no stonings of Pastor Ben next week. All right. But I am saying go Chiefs today. All right, go Kansas City. And there might be a stoning this week if I don't get back to Moses. So let's get back to Moses. All right. The reality is there are people here today that have experienced disappointment. You've experienced letdown. You prayed for somebody to be healed and they weren't healed. You prayed for, you thought your marriage would actually change for the better. You started to work on it and it only got worse. On the outside, you smile, but on the inside, you're really disappointed with where what life has brought you, and some challenges that you face over and over again, and things that you face in your life that bring disappointment to you in your situation. And maybe some people would even say, Pastor Ben, I'm disappointed because I haven't seen God move in the way that I thought he would in this area of my life. The message today is for you. And I want to give you three truths about disappointment that we experience in our life from Exodus chapter 5. The first is this: disappointment happens when our situation gets worse. When our situation gets worse. Exodus chapter 5, verse 1. Afterward, Moses and Aaron went to Pharaoh and said, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Let my people go so that they may hold a festival to me in the desert. To which Pharaoh responded in verse 2. Who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know the Lord and I will not let Israel go. To which Moses probably responded, huh? What did you say? That's not the way God said this would happen. That's not what God said to me that you would say. And he responds, okay. And I just want to say something to you that God is now teaching me in my life. Because I've been very vulnerable with you, and I'm praying, God, would you lead me? God, would you speak to me? And allow me in my life to be led by fire. I want to follow your leading, God. I want you to show me. What God is showing me is this. That you and I become so focused on the things that happen to us. That you and I become so focused on the outcome. On what life brings us. About the destination that we arrive at. We're very focused on that. The promise that we're very focused on that. God is more concerned with growth in you and I than he is concerned about the things that happen to us. So let me say it to you this way, because the journey is so important. The journey is so important. And let me tell you why the journey is so important in this thing that God is showing me. God is very concerned about what happens to us. We know that in Scripture. He's very concerned about what happens to us. It's just that he's more concerned than that about what's happening inside of us and the growth inside of us. Let me say that again. God is concerned about what happens to us, but he is far more concerned with what happens inside of us. And God is working in such a way to bring the greatest growth forth in our life. That God is beyond time and space. That God is infinite and we're finite. And there's many moments we don't get it. We don't get it in the moment that it happens. But God is producing the greatest growth inside you and I. He's sovereign and he's working even in the moments we don't understand when and how he's working in that moment. And you and I just have to trust in the name of the Lord our God, because he has promised he would start a good work in us and then he would carry it on to completion until the day of Christ. And that God is working and he's going to continue to work in our lives. Now, as Moses comes before Pharaoh, king of Egypt, you and I need to get that pharaohs in that day were considered gods themselves. That in a pantheistic world, meaning they believed in many gods, and that Pharaoh believed he was a god, and the people of Egypt upheld their pharaoh, their king, as if they were a god. And he actually probably thought, hey, you know what? I'm more powerful than Israel's God because they are enslaved to me. So I am a god over him. And he probably viewed, hey, they've been my slaves for 400 years. I'm not afraid of that god. And many pharaohs, as we look throughout history in Egypt, were demonized. They practiced witchcraft of all kinds. They had these ceremonies of worship that were involved in Egyptian culture, and they were demonized. They were influenced or inhabited by demons, and so we know that about pharaohs and kings of Egypt. So Moses was probably really disappointed, but he doesn't give up, and he says this in verse 3. The God of the Hebrews has met with us. Now let us take a 3-day journey into the desert to offer sacrifices to the Lord our God. Or he may strike us with plagues or with the sword. Moses and Aaron respond to Pharaoh and they're like, hey, that our God is real and he is alive. And you know what? There could be plagues. Unlike the world has ever seen, devastation in Egypt in a way that the world has never seen. So let us go and offer sacrifice. And Pharaoh is going to respond in such a way that Moses does not expect. Let's read verses 4 through 18. You know what? I love being part of a church where we can just read God's word together. That we study God's word and we can come and we're studying a book and going through it, you know, chapter by chapter and reading and studying God's word today and not just reading one passage and having talk for 30 minutes. Let's study God's word. Here is what it says in verses 4 through 18. But the king of Egypt said, Moses and Aaron, why are you taking the people away from their labor? Get back to your work. Then Pharaoh said, look, the people of the land are now numerous and you are stopping them from working. That same day, Pharaoh gave this order to the slave drivers and foremen in charge of the people. You are no longer to supply the people with straw for making bricks. Let them go and gather their own straw, but require them to make the same number of bricks as before. Don't reduce the quota. They're lazy. That's why they're crying out. Let us go and sacrifice to our God. Make the work harder for the men so that they keep working and pay no attention to these lies. Then the slave drivers and foremen went out and said to the people, this is what Pharaoh says. I will not give you more straw. Go and get your own straw, wherever you can find it. But your work will not be reduced at all. So the people scattered all over Egypt to gather stubble to use for straw. The slave drivers kept pressing them, saying, complete the work required for you each day, just as when you had straw. The Israelite foremen appointed by Pharaoh's slave drivers were beaten and were asked, why didn't you meet your quota of bricks yesterday or today as before? Then the Israelite foreman went and appealed to Pharaoh. Why have you treated your servants this way? Your servants are given no straw, yet we're told make bricks. Your servants are being beaten. But the fault is with your own people. Pharaoh said, lazy, that's what you are. You're lazy. That is why you keep saying, let us go and sacrifice to the Lord. Now get to work. You will not be given any straw, yet you must produce your full quota of bricks. Moses is like, this is getting worse here. God, you said you were gonna do something here. And this is only getting worse. Listen, there are many times when we pray for something, when we ask God to work in something, and things get worse. It's actually worse than when I started praying about it or started working on producing some change for the better, and it only got worse. What I want to suggest to you is that in those areas of our life, that there is a spiritual battle that's going on. That we are fighting against spiritual forces, the forces of evil in heavenly realms. There is a spiritual warfare going on that surrounds those situations and moments in those areas of our lives. And as you and I keep praying, as you and I don't give up when things get worse, when the answer doesn't come, listen, that strengthens our faith. That you and I, that we don't stop, we don't quit, we don't give up. And listen, something that God is showing me as I was studying God's word this week is some of us live in a state of spiritual poverty in our life because when things get worse, when things get harder, that we've come accustomed to settling into that disappointment in our life. That our faith decreases. That our hope in God, in the moment things get worse, in the moment things get harder, we go in that moment, man, this is such a rough moment, such a difficult moment. I'm so disappointed with the way things are right now and the way things have gotten in my life. And you kind of settle into it. And there's other things that happen in life. And you settle into a lack of faith. You settle into, like, believing God to show up and intervene and do something because things have gotten worse and not better. And you settle into that disappointment. See, the worst thing for Moses and Aaron and Israel would be to settle into disappointment because God has a great story that he's going to tell. He's got a great moment and several moments up ahead. That if in this moment Moses and Aaron would have given up, would have went back to the Israelites and said, all right, boys, we're just going to do what Pharaoh says. We're just going to give in. We don't want any more conflict. We don't want any more to happen. So we're just going to settle into being slaves. We're going to settle in. Which leads to number two, disappointment happens when our expectations are not met. It continues to go on, verses 9 through 23. The Israelite foremen realized they were in trouble when they were told, you are not to reduce the number of bricks required of you for each day. You're not reducing them, no. When they left Pharaoh, they found Moses and Aaron waiting to meet them, and they said, may the Lord look upon you and judge you. You have made us a stench to Pharaoh and his officials and have put a sword in their hand to kill us. Can you imagine how Moses and Aaron felt in this moment? Can you imagine being Moses and Aaron that day that you watch the Hebrews that you love being beaten because of you representing the Lord and going to Pharaoh and saying, this is what God wants. And the response is that the people I love are being beaten and tormented, that my people are having to work harder than ever, being made to be slaves, being beaten, being abused. Watch what he does. Moses returned to the Lord and said, oh Lord, why have you brought trouble upon this people? Is this why you sent me? Ever since I went to Pharaoh to speak in your name, he has brought trouble upon this people, and you have not rescued your people at all. Here's what Moses is saying. This is not working out like I expected it to do. Come on, honestly, how many of you said that to God? This is not working out like I expected it to. We've said that, and we've been disappointed in the moment of the way things are happening. And we've said that to God in our disappointment at some time. I remember the time, it's kind of funny now, but it wasn't then. I remember the time that you know, I showed up for church and ready for a great Sunday morning. Man, we had baptisms planned that Sunday, and it was good. I had a powerful service planned, and I was ready, man. I was ready for that service, and you know, we had the water baptism was all filled up, and you know, I'm like, hey, well, you know, it needs to kind of be moved a little bit. It's not in the right place. And so I get this water baptism. I'm just going to move it like a foot over here. And I push the water baptismal, and it's full of water, and the wheels on the water baptismal break, and the water baptismal comes down and breaks, and water leaks out from the water baptismal all throughout the worship center, all underneath the stage, getting all the electrical components wet. And it is literally about an inch deep all through the worship center up here. And the worship team was on the stage practicing, looking out, going, oh. and like, we have to, like, adjust and move into the children's room. And, like, we're all packed into the children's ministry room. And I went home that day, and I'm like, God, really? I mean, is this what you had planned for today, that it should happen this way? And there's so many moments that it hasn't worked out like I expected it to. There's moments like that with staff members at Discovery where it hasn't worked out like I expected it to. There's moments like that with families that have been involved in Discovery and it just didn't work out in the way that I expected or planned it to. And then there's several moments that it hasn't worked out like I expected or planned it to. And honestly, I was disappointed in the moment. Maybe the worst thing that could have happened to me at any point in the journey is for me to quit based upon a root, and the root core of my soul just being disappointed, just having a sense of being let down and giving in that moment. And Moses is on a journey where he has faith. He's doing exactly what God said to do. Exactly. In the way that God has said to do it. But he's not getting the results that he thought he would get. And it's so important to know that Moses is on a journey. And his faith and his trust in God had to be tested. And that he would need to have a strong faith. That he is being raised up to have a strong faith to lead Israel out of Egypt. And God was concerned about growing Moses' faith in this moment, even though he's in trouble, even though people are questioning his leadership, even though people are calling out to him, what is going on? This is your fault. You said the Lord would rescue us, and now the people, the foremen are being beaten. Come on. Moses is on a journey. His faith is being tested. God is more concerned about what is happening in us than what is happening to us. He is concerned about what, don't hear me wrong, he is concerned about what happens to us. He's concerned, greatly concerned about the growth that's happening. Listen, Moses does the right thing when his expectations aren't met. Notice what Moses did. He did the right thing. He went to the Lord and talked with the Lord about it. His response when his expectations weren't met was he didn't quit. He didn't give in. He didn't throw in the towel. He went to the Lord and he talked about with the Lord what God is saying through this moment. And maybe the worst thing Moses could have done is settled into or given up in this moment where things didn't work out the way he thought that they were going to work out. And Moses begins to just open up to God about his disappointment and what God is doing in the moment. Notice this. Notice this. God does not rebuke Moses. When Moses came with his honest questions and he was real about the struggle that he was in, God was not hurt, God was not offended, and God did not rebuke Moses. Which leads to number three, disappointment happens when we forget who God is and what God has promised. When we forget who God is and what God has promised. And notice that God does it, what God does in response to Moses bringing his disappointment and frustration to him. He actually gives him a promise. He gives him a promise. We look at it in chapter 6, verse 1. He begins to share and remind Moses about what he has said, about his promise. This is what he says, Exodus chapter 6, verse 1. Then the Lord said to Moses, now you will see what I will do to Pharaoh. Because of my mighty hand, he will let them go. Because of my mighty hand, he will drive them out of his country. And as you and I study Exodus chapter 6, there are five times that it says the Lord spoke to Moses. The Lord spoke to Moses. The Lord spoke to Moses. The thing you and I need most in the moment that we're disappointed, in the moment it didn't work out like we thought it would, is we need to hear God speak to us in that moment about what he's doing, leading us to the next season ahead. And God speaks to people. If you tell God what it is you're concerned with, he will respond. And oftentimes, you and I are led by fire. He responds with a promise. And I want to bring that passage back up, Greg, from Exodus chapter 6, verse 1. Thank you so much. I want to just, man, this jumped out at me this week when I was studying. All right, this maybe needs some batteries. No? There we are. Then the Lord said to Moses, what? Game on. Now you will see. It's time, Moses. Now are you going to see God show up. Now you're going to see God do things that are so far beyond you, that are so big, that are so epic, that you will not be able to imagine. I'm going to lead you by fire. And now you will see, you will experience a whole new dimension, Moses. And I would believe this for you and for me today. That I would look at this passage, I would look at this moment. Now you are going to see what I am going to do, Moses. Now you're going to see what I'm going to do, Discovery. Now you're going to see what I'm going to do, Pastor Ben, because I'm going to do something in your midst that is epic. I'm going to do something special. And there's sometimes that God will light your heart on fire, that God will show you something, and it's revelatory. It brings revelation in the moment that God shows it to you. That there's a Bible word called rhema that means, hey, this is specific revelation for you right now, in this moment, in your existence, in your life. This is the word of God for you. And he comes and he says, now you're about to see what I'm going to do. And it's a deep moment of revelation, in the moment that you may have thought about giving up, in the moment where you were honestly really disappointed, but you didn't stop and you didn't quit and you didn't give up and you didn't give in, and you went to the Lord, and the Lord speaks and he says, okay, it's on. I'm about to do something impossible, Moses, that the whole world will watch, and it will only be the hand of God, a true God, a real God, that will be able to perform what I am about to do. Because in the natural, Moses, there is no way possible. You're right. In the natural, there is nothing that you could have done differently. But in that moment, I'm going to show up, and it's going to be my mighty hand, and it's going to be the last word. And I believe this is spot on for you and for me and Discovery Community Church right now. And I want to say to you that there are people that might have been out there that have said, hey, you know, Discovery is in a tough place. They're going to have to close the doors. I would say to you, we are on the verge of a powerful new God move from this moment forth, as you and I don't quit, as you and I don't give in, as you and I look forward, that we're on the powerful new moment that God is going to do. And in verses 2 through 8 of chapter 6 of the book of Exodus, God reveals himself and he reminds Moses of who he is. And he said, I am the eternal, promise-keeping, powerful God. That the promise that was spoken to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, that I am the same God yesterday, today, and forever, that I am the Lord your God, I'm Yahweh, I'm sovereign, I'm in control right now in this moment, and I'm going to show you my mighty power that is undeniable. I'm going to show it to you, and I'm going to give you a promise. Remember who I am. And in verses 2 through 7, he said to Moses, I am the Lord. In chapter 6, verse 2. Then in verse 8, he says again, I am the Lord. I am Yahweh. I am the God that is in control, the only true God. In verse 6, he says, therefore say to the Israelites that I am the Lord. All caps, I am Yahweh. I am God. I am the Lord. Remember me. Then in verse 7, then you will know that I am the Lord your God. I will know that the Lord is God. Moses is at a place where he's disappointed. Listen, in those moments of our life, God can handle it. And you and I can come to God and express in those moments our frustration and the fact that we don't get it. And I've noticed in my life that many times God will speak in those moments a promise. He will speak in those moments promises that he has given to remind his people of what he has promised to do in our midst. And he does that with Moses. And listen, when you and I settle into disappointment, what happens is we stop going to the Lord. And in the moment we stop going to the Lord, our heart loses, we lose heart. We lose hope. We lose confidence. We lose faith because we've settled into disappointment. Listen, don't let that work in you. Don't let disappointment work in you. Let faith work in you. Let love work in you. Let God's promise work in you. Go to the Lord. Don't stop going to the Lord. Go to the Lord and let him build, give you promise and his solution to that situation. In Isaiah chapter 49, verse 23, it declares this, "Then you will know that I am the Lord. Those who hope in me will not be disappointed." When we hope in the Lord, we will not be disappointed. And then he gives in Exodus chapter 6 the seven I wills, the seven promises of what God will do in the moment that you and I are disappointed. This is the seven I wills, the reminders to Moses are also reminders to you and I today about what God will do. And he gives seven I wills. In verse 6, it's the number one is the I will of deliverance, and that God will come. In verse 6, "I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians." And God says to us, "I will bring you out." And we can trust in the name of God and who God is in that moment. The second I will is the I will of liberty. And God has said to Moses, "I will free you from being slaves to them. Not only am I going to bring you up and out of the moment of captivity, I'm going to bring you into freedom." That's God's promise and his plan for his children. That God doesn't want us to live under a yoke of slavery and bondage. That God wants us to live in the freedom of who he is. The third I will is that he speaks is the I will of power. And he said to Moses in verse 6, "I will redeem you. I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment. I will redeem you." You know, when Jesus died on Calvary, he gave us that same promise that this Moses story is a shadow of one to come that is even greater than Moses, and the coming Jesus Christ would say to us that I have come and I'm giving you the I will of power, that I will redeem you. That Jesus Christ has come to redeem us. The fourth I will is the I will of relationship. And God says to Moses, "I will take you as my own people." We're taken out of the family of Satan and into the family of God. God says, "You will be my people." He's saying that to you today. I will is the I will of friendship. I will be your God. I'm saying that to you today. I will be your God. I will be with you. You and I are called the friends of God. know this in Scripture to be true. God has given us an inheritance of eternity with Jesus. Would you all close your eyes, bow your head? God, I believe there's people in the room that are listening to the Word of God today. There's people at home watching this online that are listening to this teaching today. And you are personalizing your promises today. And the moment that hearts are troubled, and the moment that people are saying in this moment that I don't get it, I'm troubled, I'm disappointed, things haven't worked out like I expected. And your promise to us is that you will bring us out from under this. Your promise to us is that you will bring us into a place of freedom. Your promise to us is you will display power on our behalf. We know, Lord Jesus, in the New Testament and Old, Lord, it just declares that it's not by our might and not by our power, and it's by the Spirit, says the Lord. And that through the Spirit of God, there are eternal things that happen in the moment that we're troubled, that God, you do when you give hope. The I will of relationship, that people are being brought into relationship, that you are our God. The I will of friendship, that we are your friend. The I will of blessing, that you're going to bless us, and that we have an inheritance, and that these are your promises to us. And that, Lord Jesus, we're reminded today that we won't have to live lives that are fizzled out. We don't have to live lives that are trouble-filled, Lord. That, Lord Jesus, we have the promise, Lord, of Jesus and the Holy Spirit, and the promise of blessing, and the promise, Lord, of bringing us out from under. Some of us need that promise today. We need to allow that to settle into our heart today. That you would take that sense of, God, it hasn't been what I've expected. That would be removed from our spirit today. Placed deep inside with a hope and a confidence and a trust in the promise of God. We're yours. Thank you, Jesus. Pray that the Spirit of the Lord would move in the hearts and lives of your people today and create a new freedom. Bring a new freedom to me, God, in us. Thank you, Jesus. How many of you guys would just be honest and real and say, there's been moments this week, this month, this year, I've been disappointed, and I'm choosing today to believe and trust in the promise of the Lord in my situation. On the count of three, admit that, say it with faith, respond to God's and the teaching today and say, yes, Lord, I believe, I trust you. Faith rising up in our heart. The eyes of the Lord see that response as we talk to the Lord and wait on Him.
Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. In your name. And everybody said, thanks for being with us today. If you have a gift that you'd like to give on your way out, you can place that in the wood box. Thanks so much for your generosity and support of Discovery. And those online, there's the opportunity to do so online. Have an enjoyable and blessed rest of your day and weekend. You guys, love you, and have a great week.
How great the chasm that lay between.